church. I want to invite you to get up on your feet if you're able. I love Saturday nights. Come on, let's worship with some energy. Let's give our praise to the King. Come on, let's sing to our King. Our God and firm foundation, our rock, the only solid ground. The nations rise and fall. Kingdoms once strong, now shaken. We trust forever in your name, the name of Jesus. We trust the name of Jesus. You are the only King forever. Almighty God, we lift you higher. You are the only King forever, forevermore. You are victorious. You are the only King forever. Almighty God, we lift you higher. You are the only King forever. Forevermore, you are victorious. Yes, you are victorious. Unmatched in all your wisdom, in love and justice you will reign, and every knee will bow. We bring our expectations. Our hope is anchored in your name, the name of Jesus. Whoa, we trust the name of Jesus. Come on. You are the only King forever. Almighty God, we lift you higher. You are the only King forever, forevermore. You are victorious. You are the only King forever. Almighty God, we lift you higher. You are the only King forever, forevermore. You are victorious. How many of you believe that Jesus is the King, the only King? He's worthy of our praise. Come on, let's lift it up. This is all for you, Jesus. We lift our banner high. We lift the name of Jesus. From age to age you reign. Your kingdom has no end. From age to age you reign. Your kingdom has no end. You are the only King forever. Almighty God, we lift you higher. You are the only King forever. Sing it out. Forevermore. You are victorious. You are the only King forever. Almighty God, we lift you higher. I assure you that the party will continue, but you can have a seat just for a few moments. And I'd like to invite up my friend Jackson, who's going to lead us at this time. Come on up, buddy.
Good evening, and welcome to Faith Church. Today, we're celebrating Palm Sunday. Now, if you don't know what Palm Sunday is, it is the day when Jesus came to Jerusalem on the back of a donkey as the people praised him. Every year, the Israelites would gather in Jerusalem to celebrate the Passover, which was the day they had set out to celebrate what God had done for them in Egypt. You can read this story in Luke. As he approached Bethpage and Bethany at the place called Mount of Olives, he sent for two of the 30 disciples. Go to the village, into the village ahead of you. As you enter it, you will find a colt untied there, which no one has ever sat on. Untie it and bring it. If anyone asks you why you are untying it, say this: the Lord needs it. So those who were sent left and found it just as he had told them. As they were untying the colt, its owners asked them, "Why are you untying the colt?" "The Lord needs it," they said. Then they brought it to Jesus, and after throwing their clothes on the colt, they helped Jesus get onto it. As he was going along, they were spreading their clothes out on the road, and now they came near to the path down the Mount of Olives. And the whole crowd of the disciples began to praise God joyfully with a loud voice for all the miracles they had seen. "Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven and glory in the highest." Some of the Pharisees from the crowd told him, "Teacher, rebuke your disciples." He said, "I tell you, if they keep silent, the stones will cry out." Imagine the party that was going on. It must have been like a parade. People lining in the streets, waving palm branches, and celebrating Jesus. They didn't realize that in a few short days, he would suffer and be hung on the cross to die. They didn't understand that 3 days after his death, he would rise. God surely came to this world, and there is nothing that he can't do.
Well done. Thank you, Jackson. We invite you to stand again if you're able. Let's worship him together.
Story is mine.
magnify your name. You alone deserve the glory, the honor, and the praise. Lord Jesus, this song is forever yours. A thousand hallelujahs, a thousand more.
Amen. You're worthy, God. We sing.
Praise the Father, praise the Son, praise the Spirit, three in one. God of glory, majesty, praise forever to the King of Kings. Stone was moved for good, for the Lamb had conquered death, and the dead rose from their tombs, and the angels stood in awe, for the souls of all who come to the Father are restored, and the Church of Christ was born, and the Spirit lit the flame. Now this gospel of old shall not kneel, shall not faint. By his blood and in his name, in his freedom I am free. For the love of Jesus Christ, who has resurrected me.
Can we praise the King together?
Let the King of my heart be the mountain where I run, the fountain I drink from. Oh, He is my song. Let the King of my heart be the shadow where I hide, the ransom for my life. Oh, He is my song. You are good.
God is good tonight. Amen. Let's bow our heads in prayer together. God, we do believe that you are good. We have tasted and we have seen that you are good. And tonight we praise you from young to old and everyone in between with our palm branches, with our singing, with our presence here. God, we have come to declare that you are good. And it's so good for us to say these words out loud. God, even when our circumstances aren't, even when our circumstances are tough, God, and even when we doubt, and even when we grieve, and even when we walk through the valley of the shadow of death, you're still good because it's your nature, it's who you are. And nothing will ever change that. So God, I pray that we can just cling to that truth tonight, that through the ups and through the downs, God, that you're always present, that you're nearby, that you're caring and loving, but you will always be good. And we know that this world will let us down, but you will never let us down. So our hope and our trust, our faith is in you, God, you alone. And it's so good to gather together as a church family to declare that truth. God, we know that you're here. We pray that your Spirit would come and just work in each one of our hearts as we open up your word, as we spend time together. We pray this all in the powerful name of Jesus. Together we agreed and said, amen. Amen. Go ahead and have a seat.
Church, my name's Alex.
And I'm Jasmine.
And we are part of the Faith Students News Crew team.
A couple weeks ago, Faith Students took a trip to Spring Hill. It was such a good weekend with lots of fun and growing closer to the Lord. My favorite part was when they called an altar call and a bunch of people my age went up and just surrendered their life to Jesus. It was such a cool experience to watch.
That sounds so amazing. My favorite part was when one of the students in my friend Lily and I's dorm drew mustaches on all of her friends, so that was funny. And now we have a quick word from our sponsor.
Don't we have amazing faith students? God bless our student ministries. Now, to the moment at hand. Today, this day, in my office, a woman came in who I had never met before. Sat down and said, tell me your story. Her story was amazing of how God changed her life here at Faith Church. I said, how did you get here? She said, a friend who loves me invited me to Faith Church, and God did the rest. An amazing story by the power of invitation. Speaking of invitation, I have this beautiful invitation card here to our Easter services. And we're saying, one card, one guest. Who is it that God is laying on your heart that you can pray for and bring one of these cards, which will be available at the Welcome Center? We'd love for you to pray through who is it God laid in your heart to bring to one of our Easter services. When are our Easter services? Normal Saturday night service at 5 o'clock. We're adding a 7 a.m. service and then the normal 9 and 11 services. But I would also encourage you to consider coming to the 5 o'clock service or the 7 a.m. with a continental breakfast afterwards services to make room for all the invited guests. You guys, our Savior is alive. He's risen. Why not invite him to the party of his resurrection day? God bless you. Now back to the students at Faith.
Thanks, Pastor Bob.
Our superhero party will be held here at Dyer on April 15th at 9 a.m. If you would like to volunteer, you can sign up at wearefaith.org/event.
In case you didn't know, we offer live Spanish translation for our 11 a.m. services. If you or anyone you know would benefit from this ministry, make sure you check out our Welcome Center to grab a flyer or meet one of our translators.
Now join us as we continue in worship.
Grief often comes when we least expect it. The loss of a loved one, a dream, a job, a plan. It's fickle and turbulent. It's debilitating, making our lives feel empty and void. Grief is the uninvited guest who just doesn't leave. We wonder if there is anyone who feels what we feel, who can offer even the tiniest bit of hope.
Hear today's scripture passage from John chapter 11. Now a man was sick, Lazarus, from Bethany, the village of Mary and her sister Martha. Mary was the one who anointed the Lord with perfume and wiped his feet with her hair, and it was her brother Lazarus who was sick. So the sisters sent a message to him, Lord, the one you love is sick. And when Jesus heard it, he said, this sickness will not end in death, but is for the glory of God, so that the Son of God may be glorified through it. Now Jesus loved Martha, her sister, and Lazarus. So when he heard that he was sick, he stayed 2 more days in the place where he was. Then after that, he said to the disciples, "Let's go to Judea again." "Rabbi," the disciples told him, "just now the Jews tried to stone you, and you're going there again?" "Aren't there 12 hours in a day?" Jesus answered. "If anyone walks during the day, he doesn't stumble, because he sees the light of this world. But if anyone walks during the night, he does stumble, because the light is not in him." He said this, and then he told them, "Our friend Lazarus has fallen asleep, and I am on my way to wake him up." Then the disciples said to him, "Lord, if he has fallen asleep, he will get well." Jesus, however, was speaking about his death, but they thought he was speaking about natural sleep. So Jesus then told them plainly, "Lazarus has died. I'm glad for you that I wasn't there so that you may believe, but let's go to him." Then Thomas, called Twin, said to his fellow disciples, "Let's go too, so that we may die with him." When Jesus arrived, he found that Lazarus had already been in the tomb 4 days. Bethany was near Jerusalem, less than 2 miles away. Many of the Jews had come to Martha and Mary to comfort them about their brother. As soon as Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she went to meet him, but Mary remained seated in the house. Then Martha said to Jesus, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother wouldn't have died. Yet, even now I know that whatever you ask from God, God will give you." "Your brother will rise again," Jesus told her. Martha said to him, "I know that he will rise again in the resurrection at the last day." Jesus said to her, "I am the resurrection and the life. The one who believes in me, even if he dies, will live. Everyone who lives and believes in me will never die. Do you believe this?" "Yes, Lord," she told him. "I believe you are the Messiah, the Son of God, who comes into the world." Having said this, she went back and called her sister Mary, saying in private, "The teacher is here and is calling for you." As soon as Mary heard this, she got up quickly and went to him. Jesus had not yet come into the village, but was still in the place where Martha had met him. The Jews who were with her in the house consoling her saw that Mary got up quickly and went out. They followed her, supposing that she was going to the tomb to cry there. As soon as Mary came to where Jesus was and saw him, she fell at his feet and told him, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother wouldn't have died." When Jesus saw her crying and the Jews who had come with her crying, he was deeply moved in his spirit and troubled. "Where have you put him?" he asked. "Lord," they told him, "come and see." And Jesus wept. So the Jews said, "See how he loved him." But some of them said, "Couldn't he who opened the blind man's eyes also have kept this man from dying?" Then Jesus, deeply moved again, came to the tomb. It was a cave, and a stone was lying against it. "Remove the stone," Jesus said. Martha, the dead man's sister, told him, "Lord, there is already a stench because he's been dead 4 days." But Jesus said to her, "Didn't I tell you that if you believed, you would see the glory of God?" So they removed the stone. Then Jesus raised his eyes and said, "Father, I thank you that you heard me. I know that you always hear me, but because of the crowd standing here, I said this so that they may believe you sent me." After he said this, he shouted with a loud voice, "Lazarus, come out." The dead man came out, bound hand and foot with linen strips and with his face wrapped in a cloth. Jesus said to them, "Unwrap him and let him go." Will you pray with me? Father, thank you so much for allowing us to gather here. I thank you for your word that we can read, and I pray now that as we turn our eyes on your scripture, Father, that you would limit any distractions that we have. We focus our hearts and our minds and our attention upon you now, Lord. Would you use Pastor Bob to teach, God? I thank you for your people. I thank you for your word. We give this time to you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen. Thank you so much, Allie, for reading God's word so beautifully. What a story, huh? Isn't that an amazing story of grief in the Bible? Well, we're at the concluding part of a series called He Gets Us. God has been on the move during the series. Across our five campuses, where on average growth has been about 300 to 400 people. That's just amazing. Thank the Lord for what he's doing. And today we're going to look at grief. And unfortunately, you can imagine after 35 years of ministry, I've seen a lot of grief. I've walked with people in the hardest moments of their lives. I've walked with people who've been diagnosed with disease from the moment they were diagnosed to their death. I've walked with family where there was suicide. I've walked in the middle of the night into a hospital room where the person was murdered. I've seen prolonged death. I've seen pedestrians that were hit and killed. I've walked with the families of spouses that lost loved ones, parents that lost teenagers, children born without life, car accidents, snowmobile accidents, drunk drivers, old age, and young age. Grief is real. It's real to me as well. I lost my dad, my mom, my brother-in-law, 47 years old, of just a dynamic Christian, of brain cancer. A friend in college, we played a lot of basketball together. I got a call in the middle of the night. He fell over a cliff and died. Slipped on some mud and went over waterfalls. You can imagine I've seen a lot of grief, and I know many of you have experienced a lot of grief. Grief is something that we all will or have encountered in our life already. Grief at its bottom line is experiencing loss, and that may primarily, we would say, the ultimate grief is a loss of a loved one. But there's grief of loss of job, loss of a dream, marriage, friendship, business, loss of a pet, loss of abilities to do things. Grief is not just a sad feeling. It's mental, emotional, physical, spiritual. The times when you're in deep grief, you can't even concentrate. You can't sleep well. No one chooses grief. It chooses us. You can't avoid it. I, in preparation for this message, I said to myself, I would imagine some right now, here this evening, are in the midst of grieving. And I'm so sorry. And I hope and pray for you, and we'll pray with you if you want after the service. Some of you have been grieving for years. Some of you will probably unexpectedly be grieving soon. How do we handle grieving? How do we deal with people who are grieving? Now, we certainly could go to the internet and learn the five stages of grief, and they are pretty obvious. Denial is the first stage, then anger, bargaining, depression, and acceptance. And there is some good in the five stages, knowing the five stages of grief. But I'm here tonight to communicate to you that God loves us. He loves us so much, he wants to instruct us, and he gets us, and he knows what it's like to grieve. And the story in John 11 is phenomenal because it teaches us that Jesus himself went through grief. He lost a loved one. He gets us. He experienced it. And we're going to learn tonight from Jesus that grief is big, but Jesus is bigger and can help us. Young people that are here tonight, you're in a school of grieving tonight, and you are at a huge advantage at a young age to understand and prepare for what happens in life, because grief happens, and Jesus knows us. Grief is hard, but Jesus is the overcomer of grief. Now, you're probably going, wow, it's Palm Sunday weekend. That's when we should be having a party. You should be throwing a parade. Really, Bob? You're going to talk about grief? Well, the truth is, Palm Sunday was a huge, wonderful party. But a few days later, many, many people were grieving, because grief can come suddenly and unexpectedly. So what do we learn? Well, what I did as normal with the preparation of a message, I read the passage over and over again, verses 1 through 44. It's a long passage, as Allie read so beautifully. I read it over and over and over and over again. And I said, Lord, what do you want me to communicate to your people? And here's what I'm going to offer you tonight. The surprises about grief.
Jesus will, there's surprises how Jesus handled the grief in the story here. And these are surprises that God wants to let us into the world of how we can handle grief in his name. So these surprises in John chapter 11, here, the first surprise that came to me is surprised by Jesus' response. In verses 1 to 7, the story begins by introducing the characters in the story that took place in Jesus' life. Mary, Martha, Lazarus. They're really good friends of Jesus. Mary and Martha are really good friends, and they have a brother, Lazarus, who's gotten very sick. Apparently, very gravely ill. We don't know what the illness is. We don't know the details, but it's pretty obvious. And the normal response when someone calls you and says, so-and-so is really sick, what's your natural response? Go there right away. When I get the calls in the middle of the night throughout my ministry, is there's something tragic taking place, where are you at? How do I get there? Where are you at? The normal response, but that's not Jesus' response. It's very interesting. He gets word that Lazarus is dying, he's very sick. His response in verses 4 to 7, when Jesus heard it, he said, this sickness will not end in death, but for the glory of God, so the Son of God may be glorified through it. Very interesting response. He didn't run there. He started teaching them there. Isn't that an interesting response? Now, Jesus loved Martha, her sister, and Lazarus. So when he heard that he was sick, here's an interesting response. He stayed 2 more days the place where he was at. He didn't drop everything, hop in his little VW bug, and head over there. He stayed 2 more days. Then after that, he said to his disciples, let's go to Judea again. Jesus did nothing for 2 days, even though he deeply loved them. What lesson can we learn from this? That sometimes God's inactivity in our lives is not due to lack of love, but actually because of his love for us, he wants to show us his glory to those who believe. Because Jesus said, he didn't respond right away, didn't run there. His inactivity, because he said, I want God to be glorified, and I want you to believe through your grief. I'm surprised by Jesus' response. It wasn't run to them. It was, let me tell you about the glory of God and how if you believe me, you will see the glory of God even in this time of grief and suffering. The second surprise in this passage, I'm surprised by Jesus' decision. Verses 7 to 12, Jesus says, let's go to Judea. Verse 7, let me read it. Then after that, he said to his disciples, let's go to Judea again. Now, that was a decision that Jesus made. But the disciples said, Jesus, why would you want to go there? Last time you were there, they tried to stone you. They tried to kill you. Jesus said in verse 11, well, I want to go there because I want to wake up Lazarus. He's fallen asleep. I'm fascinated by that decision that Jesus said, I'm going to go to the place that's dangerous. Why? Because here's the lesson. Jesus doesn't want us. Sometimes Jesus doesn't make sense in his decisions because we think it should be the easy answer. And sometimes Jesus said, I want to go where it's dangerous. Jesus wasn't afraid to go anywhere because he knew God's plan is in the good and the bad and the ugly for the glory of God. We need to trust God's decisions in our grief. God knows our birth date and our end date. And God has never said, oops. Even the sudden, terrible tragedies, God's in there going, oh, shoot, that one slipped through my hands. Didn't know about that one. The Bible says God knows us in our mother's womb, and he knows when we take our last breath. And we have to trust his decision. It's hard. It's not easy. But Jesus said, I want to display my glory. Trust me in my decision. I'm willing to go there for you. I'm willing to face death for you. Trust me. The third surprise in this passage is I'm surprised by Jesus' words. Well, the disciples, Jesus says, I need to go to Judea to wake him up. And they said, oh, that's true. He's sleeping. Maybe that'll help heal him. Jesus said, I'm talking about sleep, meaning death. He died. Jesus pretty blunt says, oh, guys, you got it wrong. Lazarus died. Verse 14. You see, Jesus knows all things. Jesus, the Son of God. Jesus is God. Jesus knew that he died, even though he didn't even go there yet. There wasn't a cell phone connection. There wasn't a FaceTime. He just knew because he's God. He knows everything. I'm fascinated by his words. He says, your brother will rise again, Jesus told her. Verse 25, Jesus said to her, I am the resurrection and the life. The one who believes in me, even though he dies, will live. This is a fantastic verse. Be surprised by Jesus' words. Jesus just said, Lazarus is dead. They're all grieving. Jesus said to her, I am the resurrection and the life. That alone, friends, is life-changing. Jesus says to you and I'm the encompassing of the resurrection and the life. If you want to have a real life, find Christ, because Christ is the resurrection and the life. Even if you die, you live. That's a fascinating thing, a verse to know. Everyone who professes Christ, everyone here, if you profess Jesus Christ, you are his. And the moment you die, you actually are alive. The last breath on earth is the first breath into glory. Because Jesus' words are true. Jesus said, I am the resurrection life. The one who believes in me, even if he dies, will live. Here's the lesson. Jesus is the resurrection and the life. And we need to believe this. You know what's interesting? In verse 27, here's Martha's response. One of the most beautiful testimonies. In fact, I said to myself, I hope everyone prays this as I pray this for my life. So after Jesus said this beautiful verse in 27, 25, verse 27 records, yes, Lord, Martha said. Yes, Lord. She told him, I believe you are the Messiah, the Son of God, who comes into the world. Her profession shows us that she was a believer in Jesus Christ. I hope every single person listening to this message, you in the balcony, you're in the atrium, you're on the atrium, the online, you're in the auditorium, I hope everyone you could say, just like Martha, can you say it? I believe, Jesus, you are the Messiah, the Son of God who comes into the world. Do you believe this? Jesus said to her. Jesus said to you and I tonight, do you believe this? If you do, you know that these surprising words are yours. I'm surprised by Jesus' emotions. It teaches me a lot about the humanness of Jesus. In verses 28 through 37, we see Jesus emotional. I like a Savior like that. How do we see that? Look again at verse 33. When Jesus saw her crying and the Jews that had come with her crying, he was deeply moved in his spirit and troubled. Now, that's interesting. I understand why he'd be deeply moved in his spirit. And I understand why he's crying, but troubled? Because he's God. He knew that disease and death are of the devil, and ugly and gross and vile and ugly. And Jesus said, I'm troubled by that. That's why I'm going to overcome this. I'm going to die and rise again so that death and sin and Satan will be defeated. Jesus had emotion. He was weeping because he saw the Mary, Martha crying and the friends that came along crying. But he was troubled because he knew what the cause of death was. He knew how troubled people are who die without Christ. And we see in verse 35, Jesus wept. If you have trouble memorizing Bible verses, you can learn this one. Just say, I learned tonight a whole verse. John 11:35. Like, wow, that's impressive. What is it? Jesus wept. The shortest verse in the Bible. But what that shortest verse has huge impact. It's surprising that Jesus feels, he loves, he weeps. He's deeply moved. God has emotion for you and I. He cares for you. When you're going through your worst times, your worst grieving, he loves you. He cares for you. He gets us. I'm surprised by Jesus' command. In verse 38 to 44, Jesus takes control here. They're at the tomb now. And verse 39 says, remove the stone, Jesus said. Martha, the dead man's sister, told him, Lord, there's already a stench because he has been dead 4 days. Jewish law said that after 2 or 3 days, a person's really dead. Because sometimes people would like go unconscious and they didn't have doctors, like medical science, they didn't have things to wire to find out the heart's still beating. That people go unconscious, where, like they stop breathing, maybe they resuscitate them. But after two or three days, but this was 4 days. His body was already decomposing in a hot Israel desert kind of feel. And there's a smell. Jesus says something incredible, a command. He commands, remove the stone. Verse 40, Jesus said to her, Didn't I tell you that if you believe, you will see the glory of God? Question mark. He's taking her back to the beginning. I told you, you believe in me, I'll show you my glory. Verse 41, 42. So they removed the stone. Then Jesus raised his eyes and said, Father, thank you that you heard me. I know that you always hear me. He's just teaching the disciples about prayer there. But because of the crowd standing here, I said this so that they may believe you sent me. And then the incredible verse, the command. After he said this, he shouted with a loud voice, Lazarus, come out. And he did. He came out. Can you imagine mummified? It says he was the grave clothes were wrapped around him. He's like, help, I need help getting out of here. I mean, it just must have been phenomenal. You see, Jesus is greater than death. Remember that Jesus actually was given a glimpse into the resurrection of himself. What happened at the tomb? The stone was rolled in front of this tomb. The angels said, the Mary and Martha, the stone has been moved away. And Jesus came out himself. Jesus saying, you get used to this. This is what happens when you know the resurrected one. People who die come back to life. And it's the same thing for you and I. Jesus is going to say to us someday, even though you die, yet shall you live. Even when absent from the body, present with the Lord. Because God is greater than death. Jesus has the power over death and can bring life even into our grief. I'm surprised by Jesus' response, his decision, his words, his emotion, his commands. Now, I want to get real practical. I'm going to give you some practical tips, and you don't have to write these down because I'm going to put them on social media of the Church of Social Media next week, but I want to give you some practical biblical tips on grieving. So if you're grieving or you're heading into grief, the first thing I would give you, a biblical practical step, walk through grief. Don't get stuck in it. Walk through it. Matthew chapter 5 verse 4 says, blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Walk through grief. Ecclesiastes 3 verse 4 says, there's a time to weep and a time to laugh, a time to mourn and a time to dance. It's real. Grief is real. Don't deny it. Don't diminish it, but go through it. It's like if life is really good over here and then grief comes, I call it the tunnel of grief. You got to go through it. You got to go through it because on the other side is life and joy can return if you trust in the Lord. Don't get stuck in the tunnel of grief. Walk through it. Second tip from the Bible about grief is to walk through grief with God and others. The Bible encourages us to walk through grief with God and others. Psalm 23, verse 4, even though I go through the darkest valley, I fear no danger, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You walk through grief hand in hand with God, every moment clinging to God's promises that he's with us in the valley of shadow of death, and we will fear no evil. Walk through grief, not alone. Cry out to God. He's with you. Cry out with God and others. God's given us a family called the church. In fact, in a couple weeks, on April 6th, I'm going to help lead a walk through the Bible kind of meditation for those who want to get closer to Jesus. Maybe if you're grieving, you'll want to go there. It's April 6th, 9 to noon. You can go wearefaith.org/SM. It's a Saturday with Jesus. Maybe if you're grieving, maybe that's what you need right now to get you through that tunnel, is to walk through it with Jesus. Put Jesus in the middle of your grief. Place God right at center because he's with us. And let the church of Christ be the church to bear one another's burdens. Third tip is God helps us in grief. God not only is with us, he's there to help us. He's our coach. Psalm 30, verses 1 to 5. I will exalt you, Lord, because you have lifted me up and have not allowed my enemies to triumph over me. Lord, my God, I cried to you for help and you healed me. Lord, you brought me up from Sheol, or hell. You spared me from among those going down to the pit. Sing to the Lord, you his faithful ones, and praise his holy name, for his anger lasts only a moment, but his favor a lifetime. Weeping may stay overnight, but there is joy in the morning. There is joy in the morning for those who trust in the Lord in the grief. God helps us in our grief, for God, grief will end. The Bible gives us this tip. There will be a day when grief will end completely when Christ returns. Chapter 21 of the book of Revelation, verse 4, he will wipe away every tear from their eyes. Death will be no more. Grief, crying, and pain will be no more because the previous things have passed away. One thing you can cling to, it will ultimately end. When Christ comes again, and when we go to be with him, grief will be over, finished, done. And fifth tip, pray in and through grief. The Bible tells us, in your grief, pray. 1 Peter 5, 7 says, cast all your cares on him because he cares about you. If you're grieving, I urge you to pause and pray and just surrender your grief to the Lord. Give it to him. He cares for you. Why carry it alone? Why not give it to the author and perfecter of life who gets us? It's in releasing it to him that he brings life to us. 1 Thessalonians 4, one of my favorite passages in the Bible. It says, we do not want you to be uninformed, brothers and sisters, concerning those who are asleep, died, so that you will not grieve like the rest who have no hope. You see, Christians grieve differently than non-Christians. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, in the same way through Jesus, God will bring with him those who have fallen asleep. For we say this to you by the word from the Lord, we who are still alive at the Lord's coming will certainly not precede those who have fallen asleep. For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout, with the archangel's voice, with the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. Then we who are still alive, who are left, will be caught up together with him in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so we will always be with the Lord. Therefore, encourage one another with these words. I love verse 13. We do not want you to be uninformed. That's why you're here tonight, brothers and sisters, concerning those who've died, so that you will not grieve like the rest who have no hope. We as Christians can overcome. That's the last tip, is to overcome grief in Jesus. John 11:25, Jesus said, I am the resurrection and life. The one who believes in me, even if he dies, will live. John 11:27, Jesus said, yes, Lord, she told him, I believe you are the Messiah, the Son of God, who comes into the world. Jesus overcomes grief in himself. This week, a young girl in our church, 18 years old, Kira Fenema, passed away. She battled a very serious illness most of her entire life. Her entire life, she knew she was going to die. Her mom and dad had to have monitors throughout the night, even as she got to 18 years of age, because throughout the night she would get too cold or too hot. And they'd often hear her throughout her life in the middle of the night asking to go to heaven in a prayer. A couple weeks ago, Pastor Dave Wiemhoff, myself, were in Chicago, went to the hospital to see her. And we met Thomas, her dad, in the lobby, and we sat down to a cup of coffee, and he was telling us a remarkable story that happened that day. Social worker came in because she was getting very, very weak and very ill. Social worker came in, and mom and dad were there, and social worker said, Kira, do you ever think about dying? She goes, yeah, all the time. The social worker said, mom and dad, can you step out a minute? They made mom and dad leave the room, and social worker came in and said, okay, you're not thinking of harming yourself, are you? She goes, no, why would I do that? She goes, well, you were so confident that you knew about death. She goes, yeah, I'm going to die, and I want to die because I want to be with Jesus. Blew the social worker away. Social worker said, this kid is remarkable. I mean, they had to call the doctor and say, doc, this is an unusual case. This girl is so ready to die. How does that happen? How can we overcome grief? The only way is putting our trust in the one who died, who rose again, and is the reigning king we sing to, and his name is Jesus. He gets us. Do you get him? Let's pray together. Father, what's so fascinating about you is how much you get us, because you made us and you know everything about us. And God, you have so much strength that you've overcome death. You've overcome grieving. You even tell us how to grieve. Thank you. Lord, you're the only one and the only way someone can go through grief and end up with greater joy. It's a miracle. It's the miracle of knowing you in this life and the life to come. God, seal your word on our heart. May we be good grievers for your glory. We pray in Jesus' name, and all God's people agreed and said, amen.
And thank you, Pastor Bob, for a really powerful word tonight. I want us just to take maybe 30 seconds to a minute and just pause and bring our hearts to the Lord. Usually we get done with these awesome messages and then we have people stand and we sing the next song, and I just feel like we need a few moments just to be quiet. I know there's a lot of pain and there's a lot of people grieving right now. So rather than just rushing through this moment, can we just take a few moments and just be quiet? But use this time to bring your heart to the Lord, to cast your care upon the Lord as we just read, and to remember that God is so near and so caring. Just take a few moments to connect with the one who loves you so much.
Standing face to face with you.
beautiful picture that is.
And on that day, we join the resurrection. We stand beside the heroes of the faith. And with one voice, a thousand generations say, worthy is the
Almighty, who was and is to come. Amen.
Amen.
Because of the topic of grief, I want to invite you to, if you're going through grief and you need prayer, to go to the prayer room after the service. Julie and Nancy are there. You can come up front. Myself and some of the elders will be here to pray as well. We'd love to walk with you as the Bible commands us to walk through the grief that you're experiencing. Also, thank you, church, for being a generous church to supply the needs for the ministry of this church, our region, and across the country, the world that God has given us. The Bible says this in 2 Corinthians 9. The point is this: the person who sows sparingly will also reap sparingly. The person who sows generously will also reap generously. Each person should do as he's decided in his heart, not reluctantly or under compulsion, since God loves a cheerful giver. And thank you for being cheerful givers. You're smiling when you give your gifts to the Lord. You can give online. You can give out in the atrium. There's the boxes on the way out. But thank you for participating in the ministry together. This is Holy Week, and it's always a wonderful experience to come together on Good Friday. 3, 5, and 7 are the services. Good Friday here at the auditorium in Dyer. All 5 campuses will come together. It's an awesome time to remember the cross. 3, 5, and 7 are the Dyer location. And then Easter. We have the Saturday night service at 5 o'clock. If you can't make 5 o'clock next week, 7 o'clock in the morning, 9, 11. After 7, there's a continental breakfast. But what I want to share is this. On the way out, these are available at the Welcome Center. You could be a link in a chain where someone meets Christ Jesus by as simple as inviting someone who's unchurched, your family, your friends, your neighbors. Invite them. One card, one guest. One card, one guest. A simple ask. Maybe it's a coworker. Who is it that God lays in your heart that you can pray for and invite to one of the Easter services? Now, if you are comfortable, if you want to put your hands out as a symbol of receiving from the Lord a blessing. My brothers and sisters in Christ who grieve, go in peace. May the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us now and into eternity. Amen. Good night.